Welcome to the Financial Management Webinar hosted by the Ottawa Sport Council and CIRC. My name is Deborah Gaswintz, the President and CEO of CIRC, and I will be your moderator together with Tom Hall and Matthias Stevens, who will be handling the logistics for today's webinar. This is the first in a series of spring webinars that will help you to strengthen and build the capacity in your sport organizations. So just a little housekeeping before we begin, letting you know that it is being recorded. So the webinar is being recorded and we'll have an archived version so that you'll be able to hear it and replay it for your board members ready by next week. Also, the audio is on only for the presenters. Therefore, please feel free to ask your questions using the chat box. It allows us to minimize the noise and to keep it nice and clear as we're moving along. There will be pauses throughout the presentation with polls and opportunities that any of the questions you've typed in will be able to share with the presenter. So with that in mind, it also means don't hesitate to use the chat box to share your insights, your experience, and the questions throughout the presentation. So at this point, very pleased to introduce Marcy Morris, the Executive Director of the Ottawa Sport Council, to say a few words and to introduce today's presenter. Marcy?
Thanks very much, Deborah, and thank you to everybody for joining us today. A number of you are aware of what the Ottawa Sport Council is all about, but just in case you aren't, for those who are new to our organization, we are a nonprofit organization which represents sport in the city of Ottawa. We really act as the unified voice of sport in Ottawa, and we ensure that we can do all sorts of advocacy and educational activities for the community sport organizations. Specifically, what we do are four different pillars. The first one is we provide educational events such as this one today. We also provide the opportunity for connections to be made. So we host an annual or biannual sports summit each year at which we invite the community to join us and give them the opportunity to connect with each other, connect with the presenters, and connect with other people that help them do their job better. The third thing that we do is a lot of advocacy work on behalf of this sector to the City of Ottawa, to the province, and to the federal government. We do that to ensure that the sector is strong within the City of Ottawa and to make sure that we're representing the needs of community sport organizations in Ottawa. And the final thing that we do is we provide support. We provide that support in terms of the services that we offer, and we also provide some financial support through our own foundation fund. In terms of the key programs that we offer, every year we come out with a different set of offerings, and what I wanted to do was highlight the key offerings that we have from now until the end of June for this year. The first one is our lunchtime online webinar series. This is the first in the series, and we're very happy to have Krista Casey from Welch joining us to run this webinar. In a month's time, we'll be hosting our second webinar on sport for development and using sport to address community issues, which will be run by Bob Elliott. And then our final one, which will be in May, is on strategic planning, which will be run by Julian LeBlanc. If any of you have been to our sports summits, Julian is our facilitator for most of our sports summits and has a wealth of expertise in strategic planning. The other thing that we're doing this spring is we're hosting our Spring Sport Summit at the Nepean Sailing Club, and it's all about inclusion in sport. We definitely hope that you'd be able to join us. We've put the details on the slide, and they're also available on our website. And the final thing that we will be doing this spring into early summer is announcing the Ottawa Sport Council Foundation grants that will be available for this year in 2018. Every year we award two small grants out to community sport organizations who want to increase the accessibility of sport to people who might not otherwise be able to access sport, be it for physical disability reasons, be it for economic reasons, cultural reasons, whatever. So we offer two grants each year to community sport organizations who want to improve inclusion and accessibility in sport. So those are the things that we'll be touching on for the first half of the year, and then we'll have more programs running in the second half of the year as well. I encourage you to keep checking our website, and you'll see what's going on in our neck of the woods. Today, what I'd like to do is I'd like to introduce our speaker, Krista Casey, who's with Welch. Krista has over 20 years of experience and expertise in auditing in not-for-profit organization. We have been working with Welch to ensure that this webinar meets the requirements of a community not-for-profit sport organization, and Krista has great experience in this field. So on that note, I'm going to turn things over to Krista. There are the opportunities to ask questions. As Deborah said, we encourage you to do that. And if any of your questions aren't answered at the end, you're very welcome to follow up with us, and we'll get back to you to help you further in the areas that you might need some assistance. So on that note, I'd like to turn things over to Krista.
Krista, just doing a double check. We seem to be missing your audio. Just checking. Yep, speak up just a little bit, but it sounds like you're back in. Okay, thanks.
So thank you, everybody. Sorry for the technical difficulty. So I've been proud to have been part of the Welch family for almost 23 years. But the accounting firm Welch has been around for a lot longer than that. We're actually celebrating our 100th anniversary this year, and we're proud to serve over 300 not-for-profit clients, including various sporting organizations. So hopefully some of the experience that I've gained from working with Welch clients in this space will provide some assistance to you sometime today. So what we're going to cover today is what I just want to highlight. That all board members are responsible for the financial well-being of the organization that they volunteer on the board for. And board members fulfill their responsibility by providing financial oversight in two main areas. The first one is making sure that the internal controls and processes surrounding business transactions and reporting are strong. We'll explain some of the basic concepts when it comes to internal controls and provide some examples of internal control best practices every organization should have. We can't have a webinar on financial management and not talk about some numbers. So we have participants on this webinar with varying levels of financial expertise. So today we're going to go through the fundamentals of a couple of key financial statements and point out what you should be looking for.
Hi, Krista. At this point, actually, and I think just as you set the tone, it was just to allow us to do one of those polls of the audience so that we get a feel for it. So we're just having that first one that just allows us to set the tone, and I think we're just pulling it over. Tom and Matea, are we pulling over one of the polls? There we go. And so with this, it's because as you made reference to, just so that we've got a feeling, how many people need to sign off a check, and what seems to be the feeling as people are going through? As we're just checking through the audience, this gives us a sense, because as you've said, there can be varying amounts. Right now, it seems to be coming across that there's a feeling that it should be. In general, you've got two people that are saying it. Okay. So with that, we'll remove the poll, and that gives some insights. Does that sound common on your side, Krista?
We'll talk about this when we get into some of the specifics of internal controls, but most organizations do require two signatures, and it is a good practice. So we'll talk about that more in detail when we get to that for sure. So when I get into internal controls, I want to basically give you the brief understanding that internal controls are safeguards to help protect the organization from any mistakes occurring, or even worse, from fraud or theft. So So when designing your internal controls, you should keep in mind the concept of segregation of duties. And what that means is that at least two people are responsible for the separate parts of any task. So segregation of duties is easy to implement for a large organization, as you have a lot of people that can be involved in numerous checks and balances, and therefore collusion would be difficult, but definitely not impossible. Segregation of duties is still possible in smaller organizations, but it's much more difficult as the control of the funds often ends up in the hands of one person or a very, very small group of people, which probably explains why you have on that poll that you just did earlier that some people did answer that their one person can sign off on that check, which I definitely do see in some instances. So there are three basic functions that should always be conducted by different people. And this is the basic concept of segregation of duties. So first is the custody of the assets. So let's use cash as an example. It's an asset that most organizations have, and it's pretty valuable to pretty much everybody. So cash usually takes two forms. It's either held in the bank in a bank account, or there's physical cash on hand, like deposits that haven't made it yet to the bank, or there might be some petty cash. So the person who holds the cash should not be the same person who's authorized to spend the cash. And the person who holds the cash or is authorized to spend it should not also be the person who does the books, as they can easily hide what actually occurred. So when someone is involved in two or more of these functions without appropriate supervision, that's where fraud is most likely to occur. So here I've got some examples of basic internal controls that everyone should implement. So they seem to revolve around cash, is because this is the most common and valuable asset that most of the organizations would have. So I'll go to this example. So the first example has to do with bank reconciliations. So bank reconciliation is basically some sort of explanation of the difference between the cash that you would see on the bank statement and what is actually recorded as the bank balance in the books. So sometimes they're not going to be the same amount, because sometimes you've written some checks and they haven't yet been cashed by the person, or you've received money as a deposit that needs to be deposited, but it hasn't quite made it to the bank yet, or the bank hasn't processed it yet. So there's going to be some timing differences, and somebody should be reviewing or approving the bank reconciliation, someone other than the bookkeeper or the person who's preparing the books. Because the bank reconciliation is usually an area where you can see if there's anything inappropriate going on. That's where the telltale signs will often appear in the bank reconciliation. So basically, what should you be doing when you're looking at a bank reconciliation is you want to look for any old items that should have cleared the bank by now. So are there like old checks from 2-3 years ago that whatever happened to these checks, you might want to follow up on that just to make sure that those were legitimate items that were recorded, or if those checks were lost, maybe they should be replaced. But you should also look for names on the bank reconciliation of deposits, or in particularly though the checks, the amounts that payments are made to, if, for any names that you don't recognize and that you wouldn't expect to be people or companies that you would write checks to. You also want to look for unusual items that might indicate what us accountants like to call a plug, that someone might do just because the bank doesn't reconcile, and so there's some transactions that they have gone through the bank that haven't been appropriately treated in the books, and so they, what we call, plug the bank, the books, to make it balance, to make this bank reconciliation work. So you want to look for anything that looks like it might be. The second area is you want to have control around the payments and expenses. So make sure that the cash only leaves the bank account for legitimate expenses. So, because once it leaves the bank account, it's gone forever, right? So you want to really make sure that you really have good control over the cash that leaves the bank account. So one common way of doing it, which we talked about in our poll, was having payments approved by two individuals. So the common form would be in checks. So checks should be signed by two individuals whenever possible. That should be your policy. It's a good practice to have. I know it can be cumbersome, because if you have an organization with two signing authorities that might be on opposite ends of town and you need to pay certain vendors, it can be quite a hassle to drive those checks all over town or couriering them out, trying to get them signed so that you can send them out to whoever needs to be paid. So it's not always the most efficient, but it's definitely the best control to have when it comes to controlling payments. What some organizations have been doing to sort of save time on the whole coordinating the check signing is that they've set up certain vendors for electronic payments. And so they use that more often. And that, if that's something that's of interest to you, you can definitely check with your bank to see what your options are when it comes to that. Every bank has different packages and options and controls that it has available to you. So maybe you want to check with your bank to see what your options are. But basically, you want to make sure that whatever electronic payment system you set up, that the key controls of having two different individuals approving the payment still occurs when you do electronic payment. I also want to just mention about automatic payments. Sometimes you might set up, let's say, your rent to be paid automatically withdrawn from your bank account every month. And that might be a good way to, maybe those types of expenses or certain vendors can be automatically withdrawn from your account without a second assigning authority. That might be appropriate and a nice, easy way to reduce the burden on some of your volunteers. But you should be careful on who has the ability to set up those types of vendors, because you don't want to have a situation where the Enbridge gas or the hydro expenses are going through this account, but it ends up being the president's hydro bill instead of the bill for the club. Same thing when it comes to credit card payments. I know a lot of organizations, they might have a corporate card or a card that is in the name of the organization that board members or employees can use. And what they'll often do is they'll set it up to be with the bank, sorry, the credit card balance to be automatically withdrawn from the bank account on the due date. So that way they can avoid having to pay the high interest that is owing on credit card statements. The problem with that is that if it automatically comes out of the bank account, there might not be anybody really looking at the credit card statement to making sure that those charges are legitimate charges. So you want to make sure that you still have that control over the credit card payments. So that being said, when two people sign or approve payments, you should make sure that they are provided with the supporting documentation for those payments with their check or their electronic payment request, so that they know what they're signing the check for. So it's not just a stack of checks with a bunch of different vendors for varying amounts, when they might not necessarily know, like, if those are legitimate expenses. They might be common vendors, but they might be common vendors for everybody and might not be appropriate for the organization. Another practice that's best to avoid is to not have pre-signed checks. So especially if you're dealing with actual physical checks, when I mentioned earlier, the hassle of having to drive across town to get get signing authorities to physically sign the checks can be cumbersome. If you know one of the signing authorities is going to be away or is not going to be available or doesn't want to be bothered, you don't want them to pre-sign a stack of checks and have those locked up, because they're signing, you basically just circumvented this whole control, which is a very important control. So they've obviously haven't looked at the supporting documentation before they sign the check. The last comment I have when it comes to the payments and expenses has to do to make sure that you have appropriate approval of employee or board expense reimbursements. So what you want to make sure is that you're not setting yourself up for the situation where an individual is paying themselves for expenses. So if I'm a board member, I might incur expenses on behalf of the organization and then submit a claim and get reimbursed, but I shouldn't be the one that's signing that check either. Definitely not the only person signing that check, but whenever possible, you want two different people to look at this and approve it to have the check signed. So you want to avoid.
So Krista, this is like a perfect spot where we've got some questions already right now before we're going into our poll. And dealing with the e-transfers that you made reference to, or the payment of electronic processing coming in, is it possible to do the two signatures electronically? And I guess that was just even a logistical question referring to that.
It is definitely possible. Some banks, what they can do is they can set you up with some sort of fob or token where it's a an individual, different individuals can have access to the bank account, and they have unique identifiers, like that sort of validate that they're the ones that are logging in, and you can have it set up so that you can approve certain amounts, that certain transactions have to be approved by two individuals, and those two individuals have to approve it before it actually gets withdrawn from the bank account. So, but it's always best to discuss your options with your bank, because
can that signature that approves the expense be enough so that it occurs right away, that it's, I guess, in essence, been approved beforehand, and then the cash be sent later? So could you do a pre-approval of a certain amount?
Some organizations, what they do instead of that, of having a pre-approval, because a pre-approval is never really a good idea, because you never actually know, or you never have, you have a risk the chance that there isn't the follow-up after the fact to make sure that that actually happened. And also, once the cash leaves the bank account, it's gone forever. But what some organizations will do is have a threshold and say expenses up to a certain amount need to be signed by, depending on the size of your organization, it might be up to $1,000, $500, or $5,000. Expenses or payments up to this amount can be signed by one individual, and then everything else has to be signed by two. But it really depends on, so that's not perfect. Obviously, it's always best to have two individuals, but sometimes the internal controls are so cumbersome that you're willing to take some risk that...
And I think that actually speaks to one of the other questions that was saying the development of a policy where, for example, staff can spend up to, you know, $200 with receipts, but above that it needs approval. Is that kind of speaking to that same idea?
By doing that, you're giving a little bit of flexibility so that the staff can still make decisions, everyday decisions, and they might have common transactions that might go under this, say, $200 threshold, and the board is comfortable with them going and doing that. But that the risk of, like, if there was a risk of fraud or something like that were to happen, well, it's going to be limited to a smaller group.
And speaking to that, now that you just made reference to the board as well, one of our other questions was, how often should the board review the financial reports?
I'm going to get to that a little bit on the next slide, but it's typically monthly. So every time the board meets, if the board meets on a monthly basis, they should review them monthly, but they definitely should not be less than quarterly, because I think after 3 months have passed, a lot can really happen in those 3 months.
So then that takes us now to just kind of a comment about what is the best practice that can be used to prevent theft of the petty cash. And we've had some great input in the poll on the side here, where people are obviously sharing some of their best practices, where it's perhaps limited to a smaller amount, that it is only one person that has responsibility for it. Perhaps it's kept in a locked drawer where only one person has a key. No petty cash at all, locked away. So turning that over to you, these are actually all really good suggestions. On your side, Krista?
Everybody has different ways that they can manage the petty cash. And as long as you keep in mind, as long as the cash is secure and has limited access to it, and that it is monitored, that somebody does check to make sure that the money is there and looks at the receipts, then that's fine. I don't think you need to implement stringent controls on petty cash, especially if you keep the petty cash float balance to a modest level. So the next set of controls that we have has to do with the deposits and revenue. So earlier I was making reference to making sure that you control the cash that leaves the bank account. When we're looking at these types of internal controls, we want to make sure that all the cash that the organization receives ends up in the bank account. So One way is to limit the actual amount of cash that is accepted. So cash, actual physical cash, can easily be stolen and nobody would notice and there's no trace of where it has gone. So you want to limit that exposure as much as possible. Nowadays, it's much easier to do that if you can accept e-transfers from your customers or members or participants. There's credit cards, like you can set up with your bank or some other service provider, a method of being able to accept credit card or debit card type information or transactions, then that will limit the amount of cash that you actually accept. If you come into a situation where you do have to receive cash, it is important to have cash counted by two people together at the same time, and that they both sign off that these are the amount of cash that was actually collected and exists. And it's important to have two people because, and hopefully unrelated people, like not a husband-wife situation, two unrelated people just to protect everybody's best interests, and it just provides less of an opportunity of there being some sort of collusion. Now, let's say they both sign the cash count and it's in an envelope and everything's great, but then you want to make sure that cash is not just sitting in an envelope on somebody's desk waiting for it to be deposited into the bank. You want to make sure that the cash and any checks collected are secure, so in a locked box or something like that, or a locked drawer, until it's actually deposited at the bank. Another good practice to have is to do some sort of reasonableness of comparing the revenues or the deposits that are made in the bank account to the membership database or attendance records. So hopefully there's like a register or somebody who's maintains who the members are, how many members we have this year, and somebody should compare that to the amount that's actually deposited in the books, into the bank account and in the books, to make sure that if there's any differences, does that make sense? Oh, well, we haven't collected from five members, or there's some memberships that we offer free of charge, that type of thing. So just to compare to make sure that the what has actually made it to the bank and what's recorded in the books makes sense. And finally, I'll get into the oversight of the board. So an important control or an overriding control for an organization is to make sure that the board is involved in the internal control process. So they can do that by setting the tone for the organization from the top. So they can be involved by providing oversight and asking questions. And that is really important so that people know that there's always somebody watching and that they will be accountable for any shortfalls in cash and that somebody is looking at this, so that when people know that somebody is looking or monitoring, then there's less likely of those types of instances to arise. So one way is to make sure that the board should require regular reporting. So regular financial reporting, and as we talked about earlier in one of the polls or one of the comments, is that the board should hopefully review the financial statements or the financial activities of the organization once a month. And if that's not possible, then it should not be fewer than once a quarter, because that's 3 months that has passed that nobody has looked to make sure to see where we are and be in line with what we expected. And so decisions could be made over the last 3 months that maybe are no longer appropriate because of the current situation of the organization's finances. The board should also be involved in the approval of budgets. And the budgets should be approved in advance of the upcoming fiscal year or an event. And the board should compare the budgets to the actual results. And that holds people accountable for the decisions that are made and helps to identify any issues or red flags that might have occurred between what actually happened and what we anticipated or what we hoped would happen. And finally, I want to point out that it's important for board members to ask questions. Even if you're not a numbers person, ask questions. I've been involved in a lot of board meetings, one as a volunteer and then also many more as being an auditor presenting to the board. And I found that the best questions have often come innocently from the non-financial types in the room. And that's because they're coming at it from a different point of view. And so the financial types, they might get down this, you know, they've got a bit of a tunnel vision or going down a certain path and don't see something that somebody who doesn't have a strong financial background might be obvious to them or might raise just doesn't seem logical to them. So sometimes it helps to have that big picture view that I think everybody can contribute.
Just pull over the poll right now. We've done our pause now, so let's do it. There we go. Let's do the poll right away. And when the slide comes, we'll fly it through, because this totally sets the tone for you, which I think is what you were speaking to, because it's one of those tying in with the board members. If a government's remittances are late, is a board member liable? Oh, and this is really good, because it's, as we're seeing, Chris, I mean, this also validates as to why we want to be able to speak to it and the merits of learning. What are we responsible as board members? Where is our liability?
Exactly. So we have mixed responses. So it seems like about half the people definitely know that they're liable. And there's definitely a significant number that don't think they're liable or aren't sure. So the short answer is, yeah, the board members are potentially personally liable for government remittances. So that's stuff like HST remittances or payroll tax remittances. So if you have employees and you have payroll taxes to pay, you want to make sure that those are filed on time and that they are filed appropriately and that the payments are made. Because if ever the organization is not doesn't have the ability to make the payments, so they run out of cash and these balances owing are still due, they're in arrears, individual board members could be left on the hook for this. And the reason why these types of taxes are different than, say, when you think of in the private sector with income taxes, this is different because when you take HST and say you charge HST, or you have employees and you've deducted the taxes from their paycheck, you actually had this cash that you've these taxes that you've collected from somebody else, and you need to give it over to the government. And if you haven't done that, then as directors of the board, you might be responsible to make those payments. So we're going to get into the types of reporting that you as board members might see or might be involved in. So there are three types that you'll often be provided with when you're a board member. So the first one is budgets. So I talked a little bit about budgets, but what that is basically the plan for the future. And you should prepare the budget before the year begins. So you want to do a budget before and not halfway through when many decisions have been made along the way that maybe weren't the best of them. So you want to make sure you do them in advance. There should also be a thought process put into, you should put some thought into preparing a budget, not just a copy paste of what last year's budget was, or using last year's final results as the starting or as this year's budget and just assuming that everything will happen the same as last year. What you need to do is, you could always use last year's budget or last year's final results as a starting point, but you need to consider, are there any opportunities and challenges facing the opportunity that are going to affect this year's finances? And if that's the case, reflect that into this year's budget. So maybe start with last year's and adjust it to what you think is going to happen this year. You also want to consider if there's going to be any big purchases that are going to be required in this upcoming year. You're going to need to revamp your website or make a big computer purchase or that type of thing. Are you going to offer new programs that are going to require significant cash outflow? Those types of things should be incorporated into your budget. And things don't often go exactly according to plan, so it's always a good idea to build a little bit of a cushion in your budget. If the number of registrations aren't as high as you'd like, or costs come in a bit higher in some areas, you want to make sure that this won't be detrimental to the organization. So you want to be a little conservative in there so that if you don't hit your targets or things that are cost overruns, you can still continue to thrive as an organization going forward. There are also the internal financial statements that board members are prepared with. And so those are usually prepared by the bookkeeper or the treasurer if that responsibility falls on the treasurer. And as I mentioned, you should get them monthly or quarterly at the latest. And they should be compared to the budget. So you can evaluate how reality is compared to the original plan. And so then you can also identify any issues before it's too late. And the final set of reporting that you might get is external financial statements. So those are usually done by a public accountant, and there are three varying levels of assurance the public accountant can provide you that the financial statements are accurate. So the first is the audit, which is what most people think of, and that provides the most assurance that an auditor can give you that these financial statements are accurate. It's not absolute assurance, but it's the most that you're going to be able to get. The compilation is the least amount of assurance. It's no assurance, basically. And then a review engagement is somewhere in the middle. So if you're incorporated, if your organization's incorporated, you should check the federal and provincial act that you were incorporated under to see what level of external financial statements are required. If you're not incorporated, then you're not really legally obligated to have any type of external financial statements, but you should check your bylaws to see if you have those, that has already been decided and you really shouldn't follow your bylaws or consider the need to amend. Did you want me to skip this poll? I think we might have covered this poll here.
Yeah, we'll just skip this one.
Perfect. So the next is talking about board packets. So this is the information package that you might receive with the financial information as a board member. So this is basically for the keeping, this is the non-treasurer. So everybody else on the board is still responsible for the financial oversight of the organization, even if you're not the treasurer. So you want to make sure that the board packets are appropriate. So I've gotten some, I have some criteria that are questions you should ask to see if this is the appropriate. So first, is the information concise yet comprehensive? So you want to make sure that you're provided with enough information for the financial information to be meaningful, but not too much detail where you can't see the big picture. Like you shouldn't see every transaction at that time. And then is the information timely? So you want to make sure that you're given the most recent month or quarter end financial information and not just being 6 months behind. Let's say the treasurer hasn't updated the books in 6 months, so you're only provided with records or financial statements from 6 months ago. You want them to be recent, so that way you know where the organization stands at this point in time. You also want to be able to make sure that you're given the information sufficiently in advance to be able to review it properly before the meeting. So are you getting, is this information just passed out at the meeting where you didn't have time to look at it in advance? Especially if you're not a financial person, you might need a little longer time to digest it. Or was it provided to you, say, a week before? So you had lots of time to go through this information and come up with any questions. And then is the information presented with the intended audience in mind? So boards are usually made up of volunteers with varying levels of financial management knowledge. So if you're the one preparing or presenting the finances to the board, you want to keep in mind that boards with strong financial knowledge need less explanations, and boards with less financial knowledge need more explanations. And if you've got a mixture of the two on the board, you want to go with the one that has the least financial knowledge. You have to go to the lowest common denominator and provide more explanations and walk people through the finances more, even though it might be obvious to some of the people around the table. We want to make sure that everybody's included in these financial discussions. So then, now we have, we're going to start looking at the financial statements. This one is the statement of financial position. I started with a little diagram just to give you an idea of how it's structured. So this statement of financial position is also sometimes called the balance sheet. So that's a term that is commonly used in the private sector, but they mean the same thing. So what a statement of financial position does is it provides a snapshot of the assets, liabilities, and net assets the organization has at a given point in time. It's called a balance sheet because the assets need to equal the sum of the liabilities and its net assets. So assets are what you have or what you own, and liabilities are what you owe or your debts. So net assets are what's left over for future use, or they could be considered like your cumulative surpluses over time. So another way to look at the balance sheet is if you take what you have less what you owe to others, you're left with what's available for future use. So what I've done is I've split the balance sheet or the statement of financial position into two parts. So now we're going to look at the first half, which is the asset part. So a statement of financial position lists all the assets the organization has at a given point in time. So in this case, we've also given the comparative figures at the same time last year on the right-hand side. So you got, this is what we have at, say if this is December 31st is what we're looking at. This is at December 31st, 2017, with this is what we were looking at what we had on hand at December 31st, 2016. So what you need to keep in mind is that cash is always king, and it always appears at the top as it's the most liquid asset, and it's often the most valuable asset. The rest of the assets will usually appear below cash in order of liquidity. In other words, an order of being easiest to convert to cash to the most difficult to convert to cash. So in this case, cash has decreased significantly from the last year. So last year was $130,000, and this year it's $25,000. But it looks like the organization has decided to invest most of this excess cash into an investment, which is why you see $100,000 in investments. So many sporting organizations will invest some excess cash in a safe investment like a GIC or a guaranteed investment certificate, or in stuff like term deposits. So the rates on these investments aren't typically great, but they're more than what's often earned in a bank account, and they definitely are not as risky as investing in the stock market. When you invest excess cash, you also want to make sure that you don't lock away this money in an investment that you won't be able to access when you eventually do need it. The third item on the balance sheet is accounts receivable. And so those are amounts that others owe your organization. So you want to make sure that those amounts are collected quickly so that this asset's converted to cash as soon as possible. The reason for that is the longer an amount remains unpaid, so the longer somebody owes you money and hasn't paid you yet, the less likely you will ever see the cash. It's therefore important to make sure that someone is monitoring the age of these amounts receivable and following up regularly to collect the funds. So you don't want to let them linger, because then you might never get them back again. The fourth item is prepaid expenses. And so those are future expenses that the organization has already paid for. So common prepaid expenses are an annual subscription that was paid for but carries forward into the next year, or say a rent deposit. The last asset on this list is our capital assets. And so that's items like property and equipment. So these are shown on the books at their original cost and amortized over their useful life. So in other words, this amount gets drawn down over time by depreciation or amortization expense. It's worth mentioning that this is not a reflection of what those assets are worth, since they're not recorded on the books at market value. This is at historical cost less amortization. The second half of the statement of financial position or balance sheet is the liabilities and net assets. So you can see that the total of these items, if you look at the number at the very bottom, for this year it's $190,500. And that amount should always be the same as the amount from the previous slide of total assets. So those two numbers should equal, because that's what makes it a balance sheet. It has to balance. So the first item on this list is accounts payable. So this is the amount that the organization owes to vendors and employees, and they need to be repaid in the short term. The second item is government remittances payable. So those are items that are owing to the government for HST and payroll. And so often you'll see those separated out, or you want to make sure that you can identify what those balances are, because as we mentioned in the poll earlier, those could be personally liable for them. So you want to see what kind of exposure you have to that when it comes to the organizations. And you want to follow up to make sure that they're not delinquent. The third item on this list is deferred revenue. And so that's revenue that's collected before it's actually earned. It could be next year's membership fees or registration fees for a future event that you're hosting. The money's already been collected, but the organization still needs to provide some services before the money is considered earned. And then what you have in the second half of that statement is the net assets. So those are the accumulated surpluses and whatever is left over for future use. In this case, the organization has $104,000 in net assets and is divvied it up into three different buckets. So the unrestricted net assets of $5,000 this year can be spent with no limitations. So they haven't come up with a plan for these dollars. So they can be used to fund future shortfalls, make future investments, etc. The second item in net assets at $49,000 is the invested in capital assets. So this is the amount of net assets that are tied up in capital assets. And in this case, this amount of $49,000 equals the capital asset amount that you would have seen on the asset side of the balance sheet on the previous slide. They have shown this amount separately. It's because almost half, like, so $49,000 of their net assets, that's almost half of their net assets, is not available to be spent. it's already been invested in property and equipment. So they don't have, so $104,000 of these accumulated surpluses, $49,000 of that cannot be spent. It's already been spent. It's tied up already. It's not sitting in cash or in investments. So they decided, since it's such a big number, to separate it out so that people don't think they have $104,000 to spend. Then you've got the last bucket, which it says internally restricted scholarships at $50,000. So some organizations are fortunate enough to have a lot of accumulated surpluses and have future plans for it, and they want to show it separately as a reserve or an internally restricted net asset. This demonstrates the plan for the dollars. In this case, the board set up this reserve to fund future scholarships. So they want to show that, hey, yes, we have a significant amount of net assets, but we have a plan for almost half of it that we're going to use for this one specific purpose, and so they want it demonstrated in the financial statements so that people know that there's a plan for it and that members aren't overpaying and that type of thing. The last statement we have is the statement of operations. So this statement summarizes, or it's also called the income statement, and it summarizes the revenue and expenses over a certain period of time. So the balance sheet or the statement of financial position that we looked at earlier, that's a snapshot. So this is like on this given day, this is what we owned and what we owed. This says over a certain amount of time, this is how much money we made. So the revenue that you see on this statement includes all income earned in the period, including amounts that haven't yet been received. The expenses include all expenditures incurred in the year, including amounts that haven't yet been paid. When your revenues are greater than your expenses, you're left with a surplus or net revenue. In this case, it's $900 for the year. If your expenses are greater than your revenues, you're left with a deficit or a net expense. This example doesn't show this, but it's a good idea to provide a comparison of your actual revenue and expenses to budget. So that way, as I mentioned earlier, so that you can identify if things are going according to plan and identify any issues before it gets to be too late. So by looking at any trends in this year's revenue and expenses when compared to last year and to this year's budget, you might be able to better identify any red flags and be in a position to address them early before it's too late. In this case, the organization had a surplus last year of $103,000, and it's only $900 this year, which should definitely raise a flag. That's not necessarily a problem, but it's something you should definitely wonder. It should make your eyebrows raise a little bit. So if you look at the numbers a little closer, you can see that the event revenue is much lower than last year, and the event expense is much lower than last year as well. So it seems that their event is much smaller in size over last year. Hopefully in this case, the scaling down was budgeted or expected and is not an indication of a decreased interest in the event. So before we wrap this up, I just wanted to mention that this statement, so the statement of operations you see, was prepared using accrual accounting, which means that revenues recorded when it's earned, not necessarily when the cash is received, and expenses are recorded when incurred, not necessarily when they are paid for. So this definitely gives a better picture of what went on during the year. However, it can be a bit complicated to prepare the numbers on this basis if you're not using software like QuickBooks or Sage, which I could see that a lot of people are using those types of softwares. If you're using a spreadsheet, it's going to be difficult to use accrual accounting. So this gives you a better picture of what went on during the year. And especially if it's prepared by a volunteer board member who has little or no financial background. So if that's the case, what you can do is you also have what a lot of organizations will do is that when they're in that situation, they will prepare their financial statements using a cash basis, which basically means that they're summarizing the revenues and expenses as they appear on the bank statement. So, you know, that month they got so much in deposits, they're showing it as revenues. There's so much in checks that went through the bank account. Those get reflected in the appropriate expense categories. So what that does, though, is it doesn't reflect any upcoming transactions that haven't yet hit the bank account. Like if you have any uncollected revenues or any expenses that you haven't yet paid for, those aren't going to be reflected in a statement like this that's prepared on a cash basis. So if your organization doesn't have any debt, always pays their bills right away, and doesn't allow people to pay at a later date, then the cash basis might be perfectly fine for your situation. But in this case, if you have a lot of other assets and liabilities like we had seen on the previous slides, your bottom line is going to look really different. So I did a quick recalculation. If we did this statement using the cash basis, versus the accrual, it would show a net profit of about $20,000 versus the $900 we're showing here. So that can make a big difference in the amount of and what decisions are made or what how people view the statements. So make sure that you choose your method wisely.
That's excellent and very thoughtful. Thank you, Krista, very much. As we're going to some of the questions, and while people may be reflecting on the different types of balance sheets, and as you say, I think that is a real reality, whether they're receiving some government funding, some municipal funding, or whether it's just the membership fees coming in and different activities, I think that allows its own questions to come. But let me take 2 seconds to go back to one of your other descriptions, because it was asking questions about the management notes. So do they need to be shared with all board members, and who else are the management notes shared with?
Management notes should be shared with board members. Obviously the treasurer, but definitely should be shared with the treasurer. And the treasurer should be explaining that to the rest of the board. But I think the board has full access to whatever management notes are provided because they're equally as responsible for the organization as the treasurer. It's just the treasurer has been tasked with more duties or more tasks, but the board is every member is equally responsible. So if the management notes include a lot of information that's useful, then that should be provided to every board member.
Okay, and that makes sense. Hopefully that answers the question for everybody. One of the other questions, if incorporated, who requires the financial statements?
Okay, if you're incorporated, you're mandated by certain laws, and now those laws, so you have two choices. You can be either incorporated federally or provincially, so under the laws of Ontario or Quebec, wherever it is that your organization might be incorporated under. So each of these jurisdictions, they have their own Corporations Act, or even a Not-for-Profit Corporations Act, and in those acts, it dictates whether or not you require an audit or financial statements, that type of thing. So it's to make sure that if you are incorporated, that you understand what the Act requires so that you can be in compliance.
Okay. What kind of budgets would you recommend for sport groups?
When it comes to budgets, I think budgets should be set annually, so for the for the upcoming fiscal year. But then you also probably should do more detailed budgets for certain events. So if you have a budget for tournaments and that type of thing, and there's a lot of transactions that happen around that, maybe do a separate sub budget for that so that you can monitor how certain initiatives, how they went.
Okay. So if we have one part-time staff member who receives the registrations, the cash, and check, what controls should be implemented on the cash collection?
I think what's important in this case is that that part-time staff member probably shouldn't handle the physical cash. They might be able to be recording, they might accept the credit card information, the credit card transactions and that type of thing. But you don't want them to be handling the actual cash, because if they're handling the registrations, so they're monitoring, they're basically managing the database, handling the cash, and then making the deposit to the bank and actually recording this into the books. If they did not record a registration and pocketed the cash and didn't record it in the books, there would be nobody that would know. So you need to, depending on how, if there's any other controls, if this is unavoidable, then you need to have controls over monitoring the database and making sure that the database makes sense when it comes to what gets deposited into the bank or recorded in the book. So if it's registration, then is there some other way for you to validate the number of registrations? So if you're say a minor hockey association, and you collect the registrations, and you have this one part-time person that collects the funds, maintains the membership database, and records the bank transactions, you want to make that, there is some other accountability, the teams are going to have to be developed based on the members that are in this database, and so there's going to be some, people are going to know if there's a problem with the database. And as long as somebody is monitoring the database, in some, like there's some other compensating control over for this database, and that that database is reconciled to the books and the bank, then, you know, you're minimizing the risk. It'll be, if there's any problem, it'll eventually be detected or identified, but it won't prevent it from happening.
Sure. One of the questions again is, so are we required to do an analysis to see if HST has to be remitted by the company? So does CRA put the reliability on the corporation?
You could be. HST is really a really specific area. We actually have specialists within our firm that's all they do. And I reach out to them a lot because with not-for-profits, you would think would be quite simple in the area of HST, but it isn't, because there's a lot of different types of organizations out there, and they're all subject to various different rules. So I'd rather not answer that question. I would say if you're unsure about whether or not something has been handled properly, is to maybe reach out to somebody, either try to reach out to CRA directly or reach out to some sort of HST expert.
Great. And one other question. So what do you think of the treasurer preparing and doing the bookkeeping in an organization with a small $40,000 budget? Any suggestions?
That's pretty common, and there's nothing wrong with that. What you want to make sure is that the treasurer doesn't have sole control over any of those tasks, but like those three functions we had mentioned. So, you know, you don't want the treasurer to necessarily hold the cash or to be the only one that can make withdrawals to the bank account. Like, you don't want to give them sole signing authority. And although they're the ones that are probably, the treasurer is probably the one that's recording the transactions or maintaining the books, you want to make sure the treasurer is providing financial statements or reporting to the rest of the board members on a regular basis so that they're aware of what's going on as well. So they're providing some sort of oversight and can ask questions on a regular basis.
Cool. So a couple of just logistical questions, and they kind of encompass. So what's sort of the reasonable price that we can expect as for an audit for a sport organization?
$1 million question. It definitely doesn't cost $1 million, but it really depends on, I can't give you a price because it's going to vary from firm to firm because everybody's rates is slightly different, but it's going to often affect whether or not, it's going to be affected by whether or not you do have strong controls over your bank and that the bookkeeping is clean, things reconcile. If those are all in place, then you're definitely going to save an audit fee cost. But if things are done by spreadsheets and nothing quite reconciled and you don't have supporting documentation for stuff and you have to do a lot of that type of running around, it could really cause your audit fees to be a lot higher than they have to be.
No, that makes sense that it's reflective of the organization, I guess, what all is involved, because you can have a small sport organization or a very large one.
Effects. So the quality of the books is a big factor, but also the number of revenue streams has an impact on the audit as well. So if you have an organization where they have membership dues, they run a bunch of numerous events, they receive government grants that are restricted for certain purposes, they have a canteen, and they have some sort of like other type of, they have a website where they sell a bunch of different articles. Like the sporting organization's logo on it. Like, these are all different revenue streams that are all subject to different audit approaches. And that can, although it might be a small organization, if you've got a whole bunch of different revenue streams, that can cause the audit fees to be quite high compared to the size.
Excellent. So I think we're going to take one more question, and then we will, being sensitive to the time, we'll allow some wrap-up, but Chris, if you're okay staying online to continue to answer some questions beyond, then that would be great. So just with one key piece, one last one, would not a receipt book work to legitimize the acceptance of cash and checks and monitor the daily receipts?
Receipt book. If you have the receipt book that is, is pre-numbered so that like it's sequentially pre-numbered and somebody looks to make sure that all the receipts are there. That is definitely helpful when you receive cash. But the only issue when it comes to that, like the receipt book helps for sure. But how can you be certain that a receipt is issued every time you receive cash? Because the person who's giving you the cash might not know that they're supposed to ask for it, or they're supposed to be provided with the receipt every time. So that is, it helps, but it's not perfect.
Perfect. And that sounds good. So I think with that, at this point, we're going to say thank you, Krista. I think this has been incredibly interesting. It's our step one in our series of the webinar series going forward to help build the capacity and answer the questions that I think all of us have in trying to run an organization and what else. So just a few reminders for everybody that the next webinar will be coming up on April 18th. And so it will be working with Sport for Development and helping to address quite a few of our different community issues and what are the next steps. Certainly very appreciative of everybody joining us. And a reminder that the webinar of this entire webinar and an archive copy will be available on the Ottawa Sport Council website so that you'll be able to get that. And that will be available later next week, as well as the PDF slides, so that we will have the slides available. We also value, because part of the funding that we get to provide this is when we can show that we are providing some of the resources, so we value any feedback that you may have to share with us on this so that we can continue to grow and continue to provide additional resources. So with all of that, I think, you know, on behalf of Marcy and myself and everyone here, Krista, thank you so much. Thank you to everybody who's joining us if they're sharing some feedback. And if there are any other questions, certainly we'll stay online for a while. Krista has graciously said that she'll join us for a bit, so just keep typing away. But otherwise, we thank you, and we look forward to seeing everybody on the 18th.